Hi, I'm Brian May, and this is the first video edition of Star Licks. So I'm going to be playing you some of my licks in the next few minutes. But first of all, I'd like to take a look at the equipment and show you where the various noises come from. To start with, this is the guitar which I made, which is a little different from other guitars, but basically does similar things. My guitar has three pickups which can be arranged in different configurations. In other words, you can have any one of the three, or else you can have two or more on together. If they're on together, they're in series, which means that they add their sounds together. But I have also a reversal switch here, which means that their sounds can subtract. In case that sounds too obscure, I'll just show you what I mean. This is the sound of this pickup, which is nearest to the fingerboard. If I add in the next pickup here, in series and in phase, it sounds like this. It'll thicken the sound and make it more mellow. So it sounds like this. Now if I reverse the phase of this one, I've still got these two pickups on, but I've got them out of phase instead of in phase. It'll change a lot, and you hear this difference now. What's happened is the two pickups have cancelled out the low harmonics, and all you get is the high stuff, which makes it sound very harsh. So with different combinations of these, there's a wide variety of sounds that I can get, and I'll tell you which ones I'm using from time to time. In case you're wondering if you can get something like this, it probably soon you will be able to, because Guild are making a more or less exact copy of this, which we're hoping to sell, I think, sometime this coming year. So we've been working on that together, and hopefully it's the third prototype, which I have at the moment, sounds pretty well identical to this, and I can forget that I'm playing this, which is a big help to me, because as you can imagine, I've had this guitar for 20 years and it's more or less the only thing I can play to get the right sound. Okay, that's the guitar. I use a treble booster, which is a very simple little box. It's just a one transistor device which boosts the signal a bit and gives me a bit more sustain through the amplifier. It also knocks a bit of the bass end off, which cleans the thing up. And I'll show you what I mean by that. This is what it would sound like without the treble booster. Which is a very mellow sound and quite useful for some things. But if you turn it up in a stage environment, it gets very messy and woolly and makes this kind of confused noise. Which again is nice for some things, but you very soon get fed up with it because you can't really hear the individual notes. So what the treble booster does is clean that up, and I'll show you what I mean. So that cleans it up, and it also gives it a nice bit of bite on the top end, that nice little sound. And I use an English sixpence for a pick as well, and maybe that makes a bit of difference too, because this has a serrated edge, and you can get a rasp with it if you want. But the treble booster is very important because it also boosts the signal up to the point where the whole thing will feed back, and that's very important for the way that I play. I need to get that sustain. And in the right circumstances, if you're standing in the right place, it'll sustain more or less forever. I'll show you what I mean. kind of take your time with the notes, which is nice, and you can get some real feeling into it without the thing just dying dead on you. So whatever means you can use to get sustained through the amplifier is a big help in getting expressive lead work, I think. So that's the amplifier and the treble booster. The other device that I use as more or less standard these days is a Boss pedal, and that's a kind of splitter which processes the signal. It actually phases, it actually puts little delays on one side of the signal. So the output from my Boss pedal is fed back into a different amplifier so that it doesn't interfere with the first amplifier, because otherwise you get all sorts of distortion occurring. So the two amplifiers at the moment, we've got them mic'd up so they come through, if you're listening in stereo, one on each side. And you'll notice that it gives a nice sort of stereo spread to the notes. And it gives, for chord work, it makes it gel together and sound very tuneful somehow. It's just a nice gelling effect. So here, first of all, is without the chorus pedal, the phase pedal. I'm actually helping it a little bit with this tremolo bar, so it's a little bit melodious because of that. But you'll see the difference that the phaser makes now. This is with the phaser in. Okay, so that's more or less the sound that I... That's more or less the setup that I use to get most of what I do. The only other devices that we use are a couple of delay boxes. Now these are arranged, we use digital delays these days, although it used to be a little tape delay, which I modified years ago. The output from one of these boxes is fed back into, again, a separate amplifier so that it doesn't interfere with the first one. That's very important, otherwise they get all messed up. And from the second delay, we feed the output from that to a third amplifier. So eventually you have three completely separate amplifiers, which can be playing things which, if you're lucky, work together. And if you design the progressions of your notes in a certain way, then you can make the stuff which is coming back be in harmony with what you're doing at the time. Or you can generate different kinds of rhythmic patterns. There's all kinds of stuff. And I became very fascinated with this some years ago, and all those Brighton rock solos and stuff like that were using this device in slightly different ways. So let me just show you roughly what it does. You won't hear the phasing stuff now, you'll just hear one straight through amplifier in the middle, which is what I'm playing at the time. You then hear one repeat come through on the left, and you hear the other repeat come through on the right. So that's the general idea of that. That can get out of control very easily and frequently does with me. But at the same time, if you're experimenting, you can find things which work. And it's interesting what turns up. It might be worth saying at this point that you probably realize it's not necessarily an advantage to have more amplifiers to get louder. In fact, that often messes up the out front mix if you've got too much coming straight out of the amps. But it's necessary to have separate amps for different effects, because at high volume, everything just becomes a mush, if not. And this way, you can get the harmonies working together fine. Now, this is the first time any of us have actually tried exactly this, but we hope you can play along as we go. So, if we can just get tuned up, I'll give you some E strings. I'm going to turn the chorus off for the purpose of this, because the chorus gives it a little bit of tuning discrepancy. So this is a top E to tune to. B. (Phone rings) to G. And the D. So even if I'm not in tune, at least we'll both be out of tune together. Okay, so at this point, if you look at your accompanying manual, which hopefully you have, this will be lick number one. Okay, this one from Lyre was done, as far as I remember, with this pickup one and pickup three out of phase. And slowly, it's like this. Okay, this is an oldie from Roger's Rocker on the first album. And it goes like this. With the airplane noise on the end, with the tremolo, of course. And slowly that goes like this. This one from that song called Jesus is quite uncharacteristic of me, which is a scale kind of thing, which I don't normally do, but it's a little set piece to fit in those gaps. And I can tell it's a set piece because I don't usually use this little finger very much, especially in those days. And this piece uses the little finger. It goes like this. And the slow version. Yes, the little thing from Father to Son is just a little improvised playing along piece, but it's the way that I normally think, which is playing across a chord rather than playing in scales. And it's something like this. I don't know if it's exactly like this, but something like this. Something in that region. So slowly that would be like this. Yeah, this one from March of the Black Queen uses one of my favourite tone settings, which is the first two pickups, the fingerboard and the centre pickup, working against each other, so it really screams if it's up loud. This is like this. So slowly it's like this. The first part works against the timing. It's the same phrase, but the second time the phrase is working in a different way against the timing. And I'm using a little bit of stopping with the hand to make it go instead of sustaining all the time, make it splutter a bit. This is another piece from the same place, the March of the Black Queen, with all the settings the same. And slowly, that's something like this. This little piece is from the Sheer Heart Attack album. It's Brighton Rock, and this uses probably my favourite pickup combination, which I use 85% of the time. These two pickups in phase, the bridge pickup and the centre pickup, and it's just hard enough and yet it's just warm enough and gives me a nice bit of sustain. So here's this one. Slowly, that would be something like this. This is the solo from Bohemian Rhapsody, and this uses the kind of screaming setting which I can get from these two pickups, pickups one and two out of phase. And there was actually an extra bit of phasing used on this, I think, to make it scream a little more. Again, slowly, something like this. Okay, this is a little solo from Tie Your Mother Down. The beginning is using something which I like to do to get the same note in two different ways. So you get the note fretted, and then you get the note which is fretted on the fret below but squeezed up, and then it just lets down, so you get a little moan from that string. I show you what I mean. Oh, This is the end of the solo piece from Somebody to Love. And this again uses that little screamy setting, what I call it, which is these two pickups out of phase there. So this switch is down, they're both on, but this switch is up to make this one out of phase. And everything's flat out here, everything's up full. And slowly, something like this. This is the solo from It's Late. So, this uses some hammering on technique, which I never pursued very far, but for instance, Edward Van Halen has pursued a long way and made something completely different out of it, really. But this was a little piece of fun for me at that time. And it goes like this. This is from Dead on Time, and this stuff is really sort of fooling around in the timing and just seeing what comes out, but I'll try and approximate to what was on that little piece on the jazz album, Dead on Time. Which slowed down would be something like this, but probably not exactly like this, so don't write me letters. Fairly close. But really what it is just keeping this hand moving in time and snapping things off here. And there's lots of room for doing different things in that style. And I think when doing this, it was just a question of getting into the groove and seeing what came out. This is another little piece from Dead on Time, another little twiddle. Yeah, so the end of that piece ends up in a little harmony. Couple of harmony chords which are laid down separately one at a time, and it's a 2/7 chords at the end there. So this is what it's like slowly. Little piece from Dragon Attack, done very late one night or early one morning, probably very drunk, but was eventually used on the master. It goes like this. slowly, it would be like this. It's got one little trick in it which I like, which ends you up on a note which, instead of being fretted normally, is held up this way. So you'll see when it crosses over, it goes onto the third string instead of the second string, and then you're in a position to go instead of being stuck on the note. With that particular kind of screaming tone setting, and also by hitting it in the middle of the string with the pick and with the thumb, you can get those octaves coming out, the harmonics, which makes it just give it a bit more tension, you know, it screams a little more, so you hear the harmonics on the end. This is from Put Out the Fire, again very harmonic-y, the same kind of tone setting. So slowly, it's something like this. This is a little piece from something on the Works album, which is called Hard Life. And just the background to this is, we were doing something which we were conscious was very kind of Bohemian Rhapsody-esque, if you know what I mean. And Freddie wanted me to do this little tail off back into the vocals. And I did something which kind of blends in, but the thing I would have liked to have done would have got in the way of the vocals. So I'll play you what I would have liked to have played on that track now, which is kind of different, but then again, very much the same. So slowly it'd be something like this. I just wanted to put the little sting in the tail, see? The solo section in Starfleet winds up with a long run upward which accelerates, and the last bit is a two-part between Edward and myself, and they're both chromatic runs, but they start off minor and end up major. So the first one goes like this, which is Edward's part, which is all chromatic. The other part, which is a third above, starts off a minor third and ends up a major third, and you'll see there's a hole in the middle. One of the steps isn't a semitone, it's a tone. Yeah, in case you're wondering, the whole Starfleet piece was tuned down, so it sounds natural in D, but it was impossible to sing in D, so we played it in D flat. With the D shapes, like this kind of thing.
Love of my life, you've hurt me. You've broken my heart.
Unfortunately, we don't have an acoustic guitar here. I usually play Love of My Life on an Ovation 12 string. And the effect of that is that the third string, which will be the low string on a guitar like this will carry the melody because it has an octave higher. But a lot of people ask about Love of My Life, so I'll just play it on here. And it may be an advantage because you can see what's going on better with a six-string guitar. So I'll just play it nice and slow to give an idea of that. This is Love of My Life. Or a piece of Love of My Life, I should say. This is our first song, first Queen song, which was Keep Yourself Alive. This is the Keep Yourself Alive thing slowed down. I'm using the edge of this this sixpence for this and just gently stroking the strings, really. Crazy little thing called Love, they made me play this Telecaster, which I don't normally do, but I can get close to the sound on this, so I'll play that for you. It's really a kind of recreation of one of those guys that played with Elvis Presley, who were quite amazing in their day, you know. I mean, really incredible. So I kind of recreated that atmosphere. Slow down. Okay, I hope you enjoyed the licks we've been licking for you. And just to wind up a little bit more of the delay stuff, we're doing this because it's pretty hard to show you building up harmonies in the studio. I think it's pretty time-consuming thing to show, and it's probably not the kind of thing you can do at home anyway. But if you can get hold of a couple of delay machines, they don't have to be anything very special. They can be old echoplexes or something like that. You can get this kind of thing together. And this will give a chance to get the sound of the three-part harmony across, which I personally like a lot. So I'll try and do some things which will show what's actually happening with the delays. Here's just a phrase without any repeats at all. And this is with one repeat. And this is the same thing with the two repeats. And I'll carry on. Okay, that concludes our tape. I hope you've had some fun and maybe you get something out of it. But don't forget you have to create your own licks. I think it's a good idea to do other people's though, because you pick up different little things which you can use. And I don't think anybody creates in a vacuum. You listen to people and you play. So best of luck. Do good things.